Well, hello and welcome back to another Fridays from the Van. I've actually had to move location. The last few weeks I've just been recording in the van outside the flat, but they're doing a lot of construction work around, and I was just about to, I thought they were sort of knocked on the head today, no pun intended. Just as I was stepping into the van to record this, they started the piling again. So I've driven along to a place called Port Ballantrae. It's only about 5 miles from where I live. So hopefully we won't be disturbed too much. There is a little pitter-patter of rain up there, but not a lot I can do about that. I am in a metal box, and this is Northern Ireland. Advice that you could give your younger self. We hear this batted about quite a lot in various circles. Heck, I've got a lot of advice I could give my younger self. Heck, I've got a lot of advice I could give myself from a week ago. Buy the cake, Nigel. Always buy the cake. Anyway, what I'd like to do though is ask myself, what would I say to myself if I had the opportunity to appear in front of Nigel Cook 20 years ago when he first made that pretty poor image of swans on the River Cam, the same image that gave him goosebumps, and out of absolutely nowhere, a little voice said, "This is what you're going to want to do for the rest of your life." What if I was to appear as an apparition in front of that version of me and give myself some photographic advice? So I think one of the first things that I would say is, don't compete. Now, I'm not saying don't enter competitions. In fact, taken in the right spirit of things, competitions can be a really valuable lesson in looking back at your work and critiquing your own work. So that's not really what I'm talking about. What I'm really talking about here is competing with others, judging with others. I think that's something that I have been guilty of in the past, and I'm really trying to, you know, free myself from that. Now, it's not easy because, of course, the natural instinct of, you know, our psyche is that sort of competitive streak, but there are so many beautiful moments to be captured in the world that wasting cycles trying to be competitive. And again, this is not about advancing yourself. This is not about getting better with your craft. This is really just about competing with others. So the first thing I would probably say to myself is, don't treat photography as a competition. Don't treat this gift as a competition, because they are just wasted cycles when you could be out making images. The second thing I would say is, don't worry too much about chasing your photography style. We hear this quite a lot in photographic circles. Hasn't that person got a very identifiable style? Oh, you've got a real sort of style that I'm able to recognize. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying don't aspire to that at some point. Just be careful that you don't chase down style too quickly in your journey. Or in fact, even if you are many years into your photographic journey and you're still struggling with your style, your photographic style, I would be cautious about pushing that too much. Perhaps you have seen a certain style on social media and you think, well, actually, I'd like to kind of follow that, and you sort of maybe go down that path without it really being something that comes from the heart. So I would be very cautious about putting too much emphasis, especially in those early days, in chasing a style. Don't be afraid to shoot everything and anything. And again, this is both for someone just starting out and also someone with many years of experience. You know, even if those images, you've heard me speak about this a number of times before, even if a lot of the images that we're making are never going to see the light of day, each image that we're making is part of our journey. And I think when you look at them as an individual image, they perhaps don't carry a lot of weight, maybe even don't make a lot of sense. But the luxury of time and being able to pull ourselves back and look at our journey, all of the little bits that filled in, perhaps in there somewhere, you start to see something that speaks more to the style that you're going for. Now, I personally look back at my photographic history, and I regret the times where I chased my style so much, or I chased a style so much, that I forgot about all of the other images. And if I look at my library, there are noticeable gaps when I was so focused on one particular genre of photography that everything else was put to the wayside. So again, this is not about aspiring to a certain style, but I think we need to be careful that we don't force that chase for a style, because I think we'll end up with perhaps something that isn't really our style, or perhaps something that takes us away, deviates us from the journey that we should have been on. So don't chase style, don't put too much emphasis on photographic style, especially in those early years. And then the third and final piece of advice that I would give my younger self is play the long game. Now, one of the facts of life that I have embraced, it's been a very difficult embrace, has been my own mortality. And I've alluded to this a couple of times in previous vlogs. Now, while I say embrace and accept my own mortality, I'm not saying I'm particularly thrilled about it, or it doesn't still fill me with moments of dread. But with an acceptance of my own mortality, it certainly focuses my mind in terms of what I want to do. A ruthless prioritization of things I want to do. That is one of the, I guess, benefits that has really come out from my own acceptance of the fact that the egg timer is ticking, and the one resource that we have that we cannot refill, time, is ticking by. And one of the things that I want to do with my time, whatever time I have left, is make images, to make deeper work. Work that connects with me. Work that fills me full of passion. Work that connects with others, but primarily connects with me. What I'm going to say next might prove a little controversial. It may even be something that you strongly disagree with. But I think it's healthy to have debates where we agree and disagree. I personally think that a lot of people who are out there today, a lot of photographers who are out there today, will have fallen by the wayside in 10, 15 years' time. Now, I'm not talking about photographers who, perhaps professional photographers who, for one reason or another, they're unable to follow through with their business, and especially in these times. This is purely folks who, amateur, professional, whatever level, they're no longer practicing their craft. And the reason for that, the recognition that went with the craft, the recognition that went with their photography, has all but dried up. They're in it for the recognition rather than the pure love of photography. The Instagram of today will bear no resemblance to the Instagram of 5 years down the line. It may have even gone away completely. Certainly, it's much harder to have your voice heard today in social media than it was 5 years ago. And it will be nigh on impossible to have your voice heard on social media in 5 years, 10 years' time. And I think that will sting a lot of folks who call themselves photographers today. I admit that I have been in the past someone at various stages who was in it for the recognition rather than the love. But I can hand on heart say now that I am 100% in it for the pure love of photography. Outside of Nicola, my family, photography is my absolute passion, my love. She's beautiful, she's frustrating, but I love her. And in a way, I'm kind of excited that I believe a lot of these other photographers will fall by the wayside, because I think in their place will be photographers who, like me, are in it for the long game, who are passionate about their craft, who are passionate about making images that move themselves and move other people. Because I think from that, we will then have a movement of photographers who are in it for the right reasons. Now again, that may be controversial, and again, this isn't me talking about professional versus amateur. I've always long maintained that if social media was to go away overnight, just be switched off, I think we would see 50% of photographers out there hang up their camera. I'm not judging other folks. If other folks are in it purely for the recognition, then okay. I think it's a dangerous, somewhat dark slope, and it potentially will come back to bite you. But I would ask you now, professional, amateur, anyone watching this, your intentions for picking up the camera. And I would hope that the majority of people watching this are in it for the pure love of being with the camera. Because it will be you guys who are still doing the pure craft of photography in years to come. I make images not to be heard, but to really hear what my heart and soul is saying itself. And certainly over these last 18 months, I've been so appreciative of what the camera has allowed me to see, to open my eyes up to. And outside of the current lockdown situation, I cannot wait to travel again, to take my time in various places, to see, to capture, to connect. I don't see myself in years to come, or perhaps with the current financial situation and the current climate, in months to come, but I don't see myself in years to come being to label it, professional photographer. That is, making my main income from photography. And in a way, that excites me too. Extracting myself from the pressures of making images from a commercial perspective. I see myself in years to come bimbling around a foreshore, maybe in the Scottish Highlands, a camera, a couple of lenses, little side pocket of cake, you know, the pouch I use at the moment for filters. In those days, in 10 years time, maybe filters won't be needed, so I'll have a little pouch for cake, maybe a wee smoky dram as well. And making images that resonate with me, still approaching the world with, hopefully, childlike awe, curiosity. Making images that I can leave behind, maybe as a book or something. But simply just making images for the pure love of it. So I would encourage my younger self, if I had the opportunity, to play the long game. Don't get sucked up into the hype. Don't get sucked up into the fads. If you're really passionate about your craft, then play that long game. And remember, playing a long game won't always have an upward trajectory. You know, you're going to have periods, sometimes long periods, where perhaps things seem very downtrodden, but trust in yourself. Because if you're doing it for the right reasons, then this can be a craft, a passion, and a love affair that can last you forever. So this week, I'd like to highlight two photographers in my little Photographer of the Week and Image of the Week. So my Image of the Week, which I'll speak about first, is from Lake District-based photographer Mike Prince. Love Mike's work, and a particular image that he posted up on social media in the last couple of weeks really caught my eye, and I've been spending a little bit of time with it this past week. And then my Photographer of the Week is Scottish-based landscape photographer, landscape and architectural-based photographer, Chris Swan. So first up, Mike. So my Image of the Week this week comes from landscape photographer Mike Prince. Mike is based on the edge of the Lake District, but he also has a fondness for the west coast of Scotland. And who could blame him? Now, there are certain colours and combining colours in an image that really appeal to me. And the blues, cool shadows, and the yellows of a rising or setting sun are certainly right up there. And I do love to include those colours, those both colours, in my own images. And I think Mike has captured a scene here which throughout the image we've got those lovely cool tones and the warmer light of the sun. For me, there are three distinct players in this image. Each in their own individual right, bringing their own strength to the image, but also working together to deliver the overall very pleasing scene. Now, obviously, the limestone plays a huge part in this image, takes up almost half of the frame, and for good reason. What an incredible subject. Now, I myself have never spent any time in an area with such landscape features, but it's certainly an area that I would love to explore. It just looks fantastic. It almost, to me, looks, especially this foreground piece of limestone, it almost looks like someone has just laid down some models. But it just looks beautiful. The textures here, all the little fissures. Wonderful, wonderful subject. And of course, that lovely, cool blue shadows. I also love how those fissures almost mimic the branches of the tree. You could almost imagine that at the end of the day, the tree could be laying back down and almost disappear into these branches, into these gaps in the limestone. And it's little details like that that I love to notice after my initial perusal of the image. And it's again one of the reasons why I like to spend time with an image. Then of course we have the tree itself. Quite weather beaten. I'm sure given its location, it has seen all kinds of weather. But the beautiful light illuminating it, the trunk, every branch, every twig, we've just got a lovely mixture of light and shadow all the way through the length of the tree. Lovely gnarly tree. And as I said, weather beaten, but no less beautiful. And then finally, for me, the sky. For me, this is a key piece in the image. Not only helping the overall mood. I think obviously if we were to have a featureless or a bland sky, we would certainly not have the same impact. But look beyond the overall sky itself, and you start to see similarities between the vertical, cool to warm, versus the horizontal, cool to warm, and I think that's a really nice touch. You have the same color palette across the sky as you do across the landscape. And again, it's little elements like that in an image that I think, while we may be aware of it subconsciously when we first look at an image, and it's why we think we like the image, spending time with images allows us to dig a little bit deeper. So a really stunning image from Mike, one of many in his portfolio, and one that I have enjoyed immensely this past week reviewing as I've put this piece together. And one I'm sure, especially given those lovely textures in the foreground, that would look stunning printed and printed large. So thanks to Mike for sharing that image. It's certainly one that I've taken a huge amount of enjoyment from this past week. So Chris is a Scottish photographer from Glasgow. On his website he talks about that he does architecture, landscape architecture, interior design, event and wedding photography commissions. But I think what I know Chris most for is his landscape work, especially his landscape work in the Outer Hebrides and in Western Scotland. Now, I first came across his work when I noticed that he was running an exhibition at Tala na Mara, which is a centre on the Isle of Harris. Now, it just so happened that we were travelling through the area in our camper van, and it was a selection of images from his long-term project documenting the various coastlines of Harris. I think this was the first time that I had really appreciated the value of long-term projects. It also made me fall in love once again with the square image. But I think mainly it was the value of that long-term project view. Now, his love affair with the Hebrides, the Outer Hebrides, has actually led to him putting together a photo view book. For those of you who don't know, a photo view book is a photographer's guidebook to a certain location. Now, I think it was supposed to be out by now. Whether the pandemic has caused issue, I'm not sure, but I certainly would say that if this book does manage to come to print, then I could think of no one better as to Christopher for putting the images together. I think that would be a must-have for anyone looking to travel through the Hebrides. I love his little postcards from, I think it's on his blog here. And again, it's just little snapshots of an area. And I think I've mentioned this before, the importance of making the image, of making images that are built up around your main image. I am really guilty. Now, I will snap all day with the iPhone, but when I'm out with the main camera, I almost feel like, well, the conditions have to be perfect. And while we would love the conditions to be perfect, especially if you're travelling through a place, that's not always possible. So you make the best of what you have. Now, obviously here in this particular postcard, the weather does look particularly favourable. But there is going to be instances where it's overcast, it's maybe not the most exciting light, but you're making an image of a location as part of a bigger picture. And as Chris says here, these are just little postcards, little sketches from Sorn. And I think this, Chris more than anyone here, has really taught me to take the shot more often than not. When I look at his places folder, it's full of locations that I either want to revisit: Burnaray, fatter, say, or visit for the first time. Egg, for example. Isla, of course. Photographs and whiskey, perhaps, there. It's just full of incredible imagery, and imagery that really makes me want to pack a bag and go. Now, it's not just landscape work that Chris is known for, and I really like under his projects area, he's got some more off the beaten track, off the wall, excuse the pun, projects. So here's one, Tobermory Walls. And again, I get the feeling that some of these projects are maybe just fleeting moments. Maybe they will end up being something. But an individual image by itself, okay, from a graphical perspective, it's a very nice image, but it might pass you by. But all of a sudden, lay that single image along with these other 15 images. And all of a sudden, you've got, you know, just in Tobermory itself, potentially even just waiting for the ferry, you've got a little project going on. Looks like he did a lockdown project similar to myself. And again, I think one of the things that really shines out to me is, and maybe this is part of his architecture, love of architecture photography, he really has a very good eye for shape and structure. And I think that comes out no more so than the little project Dear Grey Place. Now, I'm not sure whether this is a building in Glasgow or something, but, and again, it goes back to that point. An individual image might not sort of stand out, but put all of these together and you have not only a real feeling of a sense of place, but you have a very strong visual, graphical project on your hands. And of course, something like this could be done on a single afternoon over a couple of days. And almost during these restrictive movements, this is almost the perfect project to take on. Now, I'm not sure the history of this project, but I could almost imagine if you find a building in your local area that you could almost document like this. You know, it keeps those creative juices flowing and brings you out a little bit of a project. But I think for me, what I'll always come back to when I think of Chris's work is that exhibition that he put on the coastlines of the Isle of Harris. Some incredible work, beautiful imagery, wonderfully printed. And of course, this one here, which ended up being Nicola's, I think, favourite image of all time. So that's Christopher Swan. I would encourage you, as I've done to the other photographers who have featured on my little photographer of the week, take some time. I think given the subject matter, I think this is definitely a website to pour yourself a little dram and sit back on the biggest screen that you have and take in some of these wonderful, wonderful images. Beautiful work. So last week, or a couple of weeks ago, I spoke about my artist's pledge, whereby for every 5 prints that I sell, I then commit to buy another piece of artwork from another photographer to the value of my highest selling print. Well, as I said, I did manage to sell 5 prints, and so I went ahead and purchased the Ben Horne's book, Between the Wind, and I've now had a chance to look through it, and as I expected, it's phenomenal. Now, heads up to Cozy Books as well for putting it together, their attention to detail, the design. It's a beautiful, beautiful book. I'm not sure how many copies are left, if any, but I would urge you to perhaps pick up a couple. Why not pick up a couple? Buy one for your friend. Pick up a copy. Stunning. Absolutely beautiful work, Ben. And this is something that, again, has highlighted once again to me playing the long game. The story behind a number of these images is most likely based upon repetitive journeys, repetitive visits, time and time again. And I think that bears so much with Ben's work. It's absolutely beautiful. It's interesting as well, as Ben talks about some of his favourite images in the book, and even without me knowing that, I certainly thought that as well. There are a couple in there that really did blow me away. Oh, these two in particular. But a stunning body of work. And a body of work that I'm looking forward to. Again, it is Friday. I can allow myself a little treat. Maybe something a little smoky. And I'm going to sit down and enjoy this book again this evening. So, Ben Horne, Between the Wind, from Cozy Books. Beautiful. Now, speaking of prints, I've added another couple of open edition prints to my store. I've actually removed a bunch as well. I'm really trying not to flood my store too many. I spent a bit of time this last week kind of going through a number of the prints, reprinting them all. And there are a few that I'm just not 100% happy with. So I've removed those from the open editions and I've added another couple. And then I've added another print to my limited edition store as well, available as an A3 15x10, I believe, print. And this is from a beautiful pastel dawn on the East Strand beach, looking out towards the Skerries in Portrush. So I'll put a link to the print store at the bottom, and feel free to ask any questions if you are interested in picking up a print. Right, guys, well, I think that's going to be it for this week. I was actually going to do a little bit of something for the weekend, sir, but I think I've rambled on a little bit too much already. So what I'll try to do is I'll try to do another sort of heavily focused something for the weekend in next week's From the Van. But from here, from a very rainy, mizzly Port Ballantrae from inside the van, I trust you have a productive and happy weekend. And once again, thanks a lot for following along on my journey. And we will catch up again on Sunday, when in fact it's a newish vlog that has been recorded during lockdown, where I'm really trying to push my own personal creativity by collecting some images and making a handmade book. So that's coming up on Sunday. Until then, guys, thanks again for watching. Take care. Bye-bye.